But if I move to Danielle now and just introduce you to Dr. Danielle Farrel, who I've probably known. How long have I known you, Danielle? 2-3 years?
From our
point of view, I would like to get to there. About 3 years, but this week I've seen her more than I've ever seen. And Danielle also is a graduate of the Partners in Policymaking program. She's also a member of the In Control Scotland board of directors now, and is managing director of our own training company called Your Options Understood. So I'm not sure whether you're going to say anything about all those things, Danielle.
Yeah.
We'll just pass over to you to
I'll just show them my presentation as well. So as he said, I'll share a bit about my experience of self-directed support and the challenges that I've faced and what is gone well and what it all means to me and for my life. But to put it, I guess, into perspective, I have relied on support since the age of 14 for various different reasons. So I've had the experience of support before self-directed support was like in legislation. So I've had experiences of when it was more resource led to what it is now. So I think that has made me more passionate because I've had sort of the two experiences. But also, as Keith mentioned, on a professional level, I'm managing director of Your Options Understood, and through my business, I use my experience of and skill and knowledge, I guess, of living with a disability to help and support others. So that's through advocacy, staff training with various organisations such as schools and support providers. I'll be a voice for people that don't otherwise have a voice, so I'll advocate for them. And I've done some consultancy work, which I guess the Working Together for Change course would fall under. Various times I've worked with In Control Scotland along the way since graduating from Partners in Policymaking in 2018, I think. But as Debbie said, that course was probably the biggest turning point for me, because when I started with Partners in Policymaking, I was probably quite stuck in where I was in terms of my support, and I probably didn't realise that at the time. But through the weeks and months on the course, I realised that things had to change, because prior to starting on the course, I had the year before moved into my own house, which is could be a completely different presentation. But prior to this, I wasn't entitled to self-directed support, as I mentioned on the slide, because I had lived within transitional residential care, so within a residential environment in Scotland. At the moment, you're not entitled to self-directed support when you live in such an environment. So it was only when I was moving into my house that I was able to think about this. And that in itself was quite a challenging time for various reasons. So at the time, I decided to go for option 4, which both Keith and Debbie have already mentioned. And the reason why I went for this option at the time was I felt that it was too much responsibility and too much pressure to take control of all of my support, because I also had to deal with the fact that I'd moved 3 times in a year. And I was also having to get used to working with new staff and a new provider, and working, getting my head around it myself, what living in my own house with residential care meant for me. And I really didn't know what that was going to mean for me at that time. So at that time, option 4 gave me a little bit of flexibility, because I took the part of my support that concentrates on my social support. So to get out and about, I decided to take that part, and I employed PAs for that. And the rest of the budget, I said to the local authority, would you provide a provider for this? But in saying that, although they still do this, at the moment I was able to have input into what provider I wanted to use, so that helped as well. But at that time, yeah, option 4 was what works for me, and that's what option I'm still in at the moment. But as I move on, I'll tell you where I'm at with looking at options and things. But being on option 4 definitely does give me the flexibility that I didn't have before. Because I employ PAs for the social element of my support, I was able to say to staff that I employed, you might have to do what you would deem as unsociable hours, because I might want to go to the pub on a Friday or a Saturday night, or I might want to go to a gig. So there isn't that same sort of restriction that there might be with an organisation, particularly if you're like me, you don't have 24/7 support. So they might have the restrictions of the staff can only work till 11 o'clock or whatever. So employing my own staff for my social support has allowed me that flexibility. And it's also allowed me to participate fully in my community, as well as going out socially and doing the things that anybody my age would do. I'm also a Brownian guide leader in Scotland, and without the support of my PAs, that is a role I wouldn't be able to fulfil. So, and these are things I wasn't able to do before. So yeah, it definitely has meant that I'm able to participate fully in the community. And I think the next point I'm addressing in the PowerPoint is what works well with the direct support. And I think this slide just illustrates some of the things I've spoken about. I've put some photos in here. So the first one at the top would be when I was at Still Game, which is a comedy show in Scotland. And that's with one of my PAs and her partner, through meeting and working with my PAs, I've also been able to build other friendships, like with her partner.
Danielle?
Yeah.
Just still on the first slide on our screen.
It's moved on my screen, sorry. Okay, sharing it again. Sorry, I realised it's moved. Is it moved?
Not on mine, no. It's still the first slide.
Why is it not moving?
Do you want to maybe try going in and out altogether then? Of sharing, I mean.
Okay, sorry, I hadn't realised that.
No.
It worked okay. I'll try again now. You go to share screen. Is it moved on now? Yeah. So the first photo there would, again, like I said, my PA and her partner into having PA support. I've been able to meet new people and build those friendships out with my PAs. The one below that is with my two PAs that I currently employ, Laura and Rebecca. The one below that was when I went to the Bodyguard musical in Glasgow. And the middle one behind me, you would see that I went to the Lion King in Edinburgh. And the one at the right at the top, I shared this one because this is my friend Charlotte, who I didn't know before I was able to go to the pub and socialise. But the reason I shared that one is because we're holding her certificate, and that was when she did a skydive for me to fundraise for a personal cause that I'm having to fundraise for at the moment. But again, these are relationships I wouldn't have been able to build. Charlotte very kindly offered to do the skydive to help fundraise. So that is a friendship I probably wouldn't otherwise have without the support of my peers and being able to go out and being able to build more natural friendships, if you like. And the one at the bottom is with a Scottish comedian who I've now seen 3 times live now. So without the support of my PAs and self-directed support, none of these photos would have been possible. So I felt they illustrate it better than me just speaking about it. So if I go on to the next slide, this is about the challenges. Although the previous slide has been able to illustrate the positives, I can't tell my story of and share my experiences of self-directed support without touching on the negatives and the challenges, because I wouldn't be being honest with you. For me, one of the biggest challenges has been about balancing friendships and the whole employee-employer relationship. I'll be honest and say, at the start of being able to access self-directed support, I was probably quite naive. There's the bit about it's great because, unlike more traditional support through SDS, people with a disability can now employ people that they know. And yeah, that is great. And obviously, you've got the argument there where you've already built up a trust in the people already know you, and you're not having to worry about that awkwardness, I guess. But with that, there's the challenge of me being recognised and realised as an employer rather than just a friend. And there's almost a duty on them to not be lax and physical, if that's the right word, and not think, oh, it's only Danielle, it won't matter if I can only do 4 hours when I'm supposed to do it. And for me, that was quite a challenge, because at times I had to be like, no, well, actually, it does matter. You wouldn't do that with any other job, so why is it okay for you to think that it's okay to do it with me? So I had to be the employer, because unfortunately, through my naivety, I quickly realised that they didn't have the respect for me as an employer, that those friendships are now broken down. And looking back and being honest with myself, would I have employed those people if I knew what I know now? No, I wouldn't. I would have employed strangers over them if it meant keeping the friendships that I've now lost. However, it's a learning curve, and unfortunately, it's something I've had to go through. At the moment, I use 3 sources of support. So I employ my own staff for my social support. I use a provider for the majority of my support at home, so like my sleepovers and my mealtime support throughout the day. But I also use another source of support that's definitely funded and doesn't come under the SDS budget, but I just thought it was important to mention. So in Scotland, when you're a disabled person in employment or running your own business, there's various funding streams that you can apply to. And as a result, I also receive support from another provider, and the staff provide me with support to help me with work-related tasks. So I have support with me today, but you don't necessarily see her because she's off camera, but she's here to assist me. I'm doing the presentation, and she's just moved to you. But yeah, so that's the third source of support that I use at the moment. Option four has worked for me to a point, but as I say, when I was in department and policy making course, I realised that maybe it didn't work as well as what I thought. And like Debbie said, I slowly began to realise that through listening to various speakers and listening to various people's experiences and perceptions of self-directed support. And I realised I had to have a conversation. So with that, I approached the social work in Scotland and I asked for my option to be reviewed. This wasn't very well received, unfortunately, and it opened up a whole other wave of conversations that have been quite stressful. And I have always had quite a challenging relationship with social work. It has been said to me it's because I'm able to be vocal and stand up for what I know is right and be able to say what I need. So that has been a lot of my challenge. But prior to lockdown, a few months before that, I was able to get a new social worker who, it's taken me 20 years to be able to say this, but he understands it. And although he has restrictions from his management team, I now feel that when I have conversations with him, I'm always giving him the bullets to fire when he goes back to his management team and he will fight my corner. So prior to lockdown, for various reasons, I made the decision that I had to find another provider because there's issues there that cannot be resolved, but due to lockdown, I'm having to stick with it at the moment until such times as I can move to another provider. But I have made the decision that when I'm able to, I will be moving to another provider, but I'll also be splitting that time between more PAs where I'm able to advertise and employ them. So I'll be moving from option four to option one. Well, it'll still be option four, but I'll be taking more of the option four as a direct payment, if that makes sense. So that's what I hope will happen. Not sure when because of COVID-19, but that will always remain my goal for when we're at the other side of this. And for me, picking up on Debbie's point as well, one of the biggest challenges is that my local authorities still very much talk on hours rather than budget. They will say you're allocated X amount of hours as opposed to you have this budget. And you can be flexible on how you spend it. Although my social worker totally understands where I'm coming from, he has actually said that when the new budget is in place, we'll concentrate on your care side of things and we'll look at other things that you're asking for in the budget, like support to go on holiday and things like that, once that part is in place. And whilst I know that that's not the response I should be getting, it's a more positive response than what I've had. So I suppose that I'm trying to take it as baby steps and try and deal with it as it comes, and hopefully be able to work with them together to, so that the budget eventually incorporates everything that I need. My hopes for self-directed support would be that it's more implemented in line with the national legislation, because right now I'm realising through my work and through personal experience that every local authority is interpreting the legislation so differently, which causes confusion for people working with people with it and for individuals and families themselves. So I would like to see a more unanimous approach, and I think I would hope that both individuals and organisations become more confident when considering self-directed support as an option, because quite often I've had conversations with families that say, are we actually entitled to that, when they should be having the confidence to know that they are entitled to it, and that's what it's there for, and they shouldn't be scared of asking these questions. And thirdly, I think for me as well, it's about individuals and organisations continuing to think outside the box. And by that I mean traditionally support in general is all about buying in service, but the legislation states that people should be able to use their support for other things, so whether that be maybe for a hobby they enjoy or whatever, it doesn't necessarily need to be all about support hours. If there is a piece of equipment or something like that somebody needs for a particular reason, but at the moment people seem to be scared or reluctant, I suppose, to think outside the box and consider this as an option. And lastly, my piece of advice, I've broken into 3 points. It would be, I feel that it's important not to think that once an individual self-directed support budget is allocated, that's the end of the story. And to pick up on that, what I mean by that is, anybody that doesn't have a disability, they have the freedom to change their minds about what they want to do in life, whether it's a college course or a job, or just how they want to spend their day. And they make those changes without having to think about it. But when you have a disability, it's like, oh my God, I need to ask my social worker if that's okay, or can I use that to do that? When life really shouldn't be about that. And it should be the same for any individual, regardless of the disability or the type or level of support they require. That is kind of me at the end of my presentation, but if you have any questions, I'm quite happy to answer them at any point.
Thanks, Danielle. He's covered so much there in your presentation. And I also know that there are several other presentations that you could do that would cover lots more.